Good morning. Are we feeling chipper this morning with that 22-degree weather? Woo! I think it's a teaser for things to come. We are delighted that you are worshiping with us this morning, that you chose to get up and brave the cold weather, to put your feet on the floor and get out of that warm, soft bed to be here and worship the holy and living God with us this morning. My name is Judy Rudd-Platt, and I'm one of the pastors here at First United Methodist Church. And let us gather together and sing the Lord's blessings as we think about what we are grateful for. We will continue and finish our sermon series on Thanksgiving, and today we're going to talk about how to live in Thanksgiving, or as the marquee said and as your bulletin says, thanks living. It's not a typo. If you will pray with me. Oh, holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for this opportunity to gather together, to come into this holy place where you meet us, to worship and praise you, but also to thank you for the gift of life, for the gift of hope. Lord, we ask that you transform our hearts and our minds this day. Let us not leave this place the same person as we entered it, but let your transforming, amazing, and infinite love permeate our hearts, our minds, and our bodies, that we may truly live into your discipleship in new and profound ways. We ask all this in the life-giving and the life-saving name of Jesus the Christ. And together we say, Amen.
Good morning. I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care. I want to welcome everyone here this morning. We also want to welcome the people that are watching us over the television stations or over the internet. We are always glad to have you here and be a part of our worship service. If you are here and here for the first time, we have a gift for you, and we need you to help us make that happen for you. Before you leave here this morning, when you go into the narthex as you leave, there's a table there where you can give us your name and address. When we have that, later this week, someone will stop by your home, not to visit, but just to give you an insulated mug, which is yours to keep. That insulated mug is going to contain information that tells about the many ministries and the many ways that we have at our church to serve our Lord, to serve people in this community and beyond, and to serve one another. I hope that sounds good to you. In the meantime, we ask that everyone does enjoy the fellowship that is in this place this morning. We do have attendance pads. I believe they've been passed. If someone new has come into the row that you're in, pass them one more time. You know that your signature lets us know that you have been here. It also helps us to figure out the people that might not have been able to be here this morning, and that way we can do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So we thank you for helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, I've got a few that I would like to cover with you, beginning with Thanksgiving dinner. If you haven't started thawing that turkey yet, or if you haven't even gone to the grocery store yet, it is not too late to sign up for Thanksgiving dinner here at the church and to enjoy wonderful fellowship with many other people that will be here. Today is the last day. Come to the office or call the office to sign up for you and your family and friends to come, and we look forward to seeing everyone here for Thanksgiving on Thursday. The UMW Christmas Luncheon is going to be held on Wednesday, December 2nd, beginning at 11:45. There is going to be a program led by Dr. Larry Zarin, and it is going to be the Bella Vista Women's Chorus. So that promises to be a very enjoyable event for everyone. So sign up for that through the circles, or you can contact Sue Niebrick to sign up to come to that, and the cost is $7 per meal. The program, or the study sent, begins today. It begins today at 10:45 until 11:45. It will be downstairs or in the lower level in the youth room is where that's going to be held, although we do have children and youth at different age groups that are going to be attending, so we'll have it at different places All of them downstairs, all of them down in the lower level. So please plan to come to that. They're going to have snacks. They're going to have a great Advent study. So we hope that you will be able to attend that this morning. And that goes on for 5 weeks, ending on December 20th. Several activities have been canceled in the church. I won't read them, but you can look in the bulletin and see the things that you may have been planning to attend that won't be here because of the holiday. Lunch with the pastors is going to take place on Sunday, December 6th in the chapel, immediately following the last service. This is an opportunity for you to come and visit with the pastors, get to know them a little better, and for the pastors to get to know you better as well. So we hope that if that's something that appeals to you, that you will just call the church office and let us know that you are planning to attend that pastor, the lunch with the pastors on December 6th. God bless and thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Owen Jones, and I'm the chair of the Finance Committee. I have been attending this church since 2004 after moving to Bella Vista from the Dallas area. Rose, my wife, moved here in 2005, and together we have been attending this church. My assignment as the chair of the Finance Committee is for the 2015 and 2016 fiscal years. The reason I'm here today is to thank each of you for your financial support to the church and to give you an update as to the financial status of our church. As background, the Finance Committee, which consists of pastors, treasurer, finance secretary, and several members of our congregation, meets on a quarterly basis as a minimum to review the church's financial standings regarding income and expense. The Finance Committee is also responsible for reviewing and establish a budget for each fiscal year. Our financial status as we speak, the total amount pledged to date is $438,686, which consists of 186 pledges. Last year, we had 210 pledges for a total of $525,131. In order to meet the 2016 budget for the amount that has been requested for budget purposes for 2016, we will need at least another $76,000 or more. Please remember to turn in your pledges and tithe commitment cards for 2016 so that we can finalize the budget for the coming year. The church will accept your tithes, offerings, and other gifts through cash, checks, automatic bank draft, or debit card machine. And I will end with a quote that one of my favorite quotes is one from John Wesley, the English evangelist and founder of Methodism. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you can. Thank you.
in our call to worship. Let us give thanks to the Lord for the people he has given us, for parents and grandparents, for sons and daughters, for brothers and sisters, for husbands and wives, for all those who reflect to us the human dimension of your love. We give you thanks, O Lord, for neighbors and colleagues, for friends both far away and nearby, for all those who share the joys and sorrows of our daily lives. We give you thanks, O Lord, for those who serve us in restaurants, in repair shops, in stores, in schools, in hospitals, for all those who make our lives more comfortable. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the family of God, for the church, the body of Christ, and for those who worship with us and minister to us in this church. We give you thanks, O Lord, for those who are weak and destitute, for those who need protection and support, for those who need healing and nurturing, for all those to whom we minister. We give you thanks, O Lord. Amen.
God is good. And all the time. As you greet one another this morning, I invite you to silently in your heart say a gratitude, a prayer of gratitude for each person that you touch and welcome into worship this morning. Let us greet one another with signs of reconciliation and peace. Our first scripture passage this morning comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 and 18 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. The word of God for the people of God.
As the ushers prepare to come forward, may we reflect the thanksgiving that we extend to others in our words, in our actions, in our hearts. And may we joyfully give back through our tithes and our offerings, knowing that every dollar given from one to many is an act of praise and worship to our God who loved us first. Most bountiful God, God who provides, God who provides the full harvest in all the circumstances of our lives. God who provides even his own son to bring us life. We offer back these our gifts in praise and thanksgiving with joyful hearts and joyful voices. And we ask that you use these gifts to further your kingdom, to bring you glory. It is in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Redeemer, that we pray. Amen.
And I invite you to be seated. This month, our mission of the month is Oasis. And as you know, many of the women Oasis have become a part of our church family and congregation. Well, I want to introduce you to, in this Thanksgiving Sunday, to Thanksgiving's a testimony of what is taking place in their life. How God is leading these women from a life in the wilderness to a life in the light. And how God is using persons to support them, encourage them, and help them. So I introduce you to women from our church family that have offered their testimony and are grateful for Oasis.
At the age of 18, I lived off the streets of Phoenix, Arizona. I've stolen cars, I've robbed from people. It didn't matter just to get what I needed. And I started getting into very abusive relationships.
I had been praying that God would get me out of the situation that I was in because I did not know how. And I thought the only way for me to be out of that situation was to die.
I've been doing drugs since I was 12 years old. I don't really know who I am, but I'm gonna look for that. And I wanna go back to school, and I wanna start a business. And I can do all those things at Oasis, so I'm really excited about that.
Oasis is a safe haven for women in Northwest Arkansas, where women are helping women to heal, to learn the tools that they need to stand on their own two feet. Our transitional homes help women and their children prosper through accountability, through employment, and through the support of a spiritual community.
I live in a community of wonderful women who we are able to relate, and there's compassion and understanding and love and acceptance, and that is a big, huge thing, acceptance. And now I know I'm accepted for who I am. and they love me, and I love them, and truly amazing.
Everybody is so welcoming and loving and open. Everybody tells you, I love you. Anything you have, you can come to them for anything, and that's amazing. I love that.
We clean up the wreckage of the past in order to be productive members of society, and I finally get to be the mom that I've always wanted to be. Not just a mom, but a great mom. I am in college now. I am at peace. We are happy, and we are going strong. It is.
So I know you noticed the background in that church. That was all shot, much of that was shot here by Alan Agin. He put it all together, who's a member of the congregation as well. I want to invite you to join with me as we lift up our prayer concerns and our praises at this moment. The flowers before us here remind us of the life of R.M.A. Calhoun. Today, we will celebrate her life at 2 p.m. in a memorial service with her family, Wayne Calhoun and two sons, Wayne Jr. and Charles and their families. So we hope that you will join with us in this afternoon. It's an exciting time for the family together. But it's an incredibly sad time. And we remember that RMA and Wayne are charter members of this church family. And they've been in Bella Vista since it was 700 people in population. And so they've seen a lot of changes. So we encourage you to remember them in prayers and to visit Wayne as you're able. The yellow rose is here. Nancy Spangler has placed this in celebration of her first great-grandson. And so his name is Trice. And so we're grateful for his birth, and we celebrate him with the family. We want to let you know that Bud Hankey is still in the hospital. Bud is in the hospital at Northwest Bentonville. He went in and he's still there. He went in expecting to be there just for a short time, but he's still there. And today he's going to have heart surgery at 11 a.m. So will you be faithful in praying for Bud in this? Bobby Platt was in the hospital this week, and Bobby has been released and is at home. Our little girl in our church family that is undergoing chemo treatments, Emery, she's a patient at Children's Hospital. She has received her fourth chemo treatments over the weekend and the last few days, and so we ask that you remember her in your prayers. You know, that's certainly not fun, and we've seen incredible changes within her body that you experience in chemo. So we ask that you be faithful in prayer for her and for her parents, Dylan and Ashley, and her little sister, Evelyn, at this time. Well, we also want to remember Martha Grant and the death of her mother, Martha Reeves. Her mother died very unexpectedly on Friday evening, and Martha was able to catch a flight out yesterday and will be with her family in North Carolina. The service will be in Virginia, and she will be there all week, returning next weekend. And today we're celebrating with Dick and Karen Bacon an accomplishment of their daughter, Lori Carlson. Lori and her family live in Sioux City, Iowa. Lori has recently become an RN. And she was awarded a Daisy Award as an RN for excellent nursing care. And so please visit with Dick and Karen, and they'd love to share with you more about what Daisy stands for and what it means in the nursing profession. I invite you now to go with me. Oh, I should remind you that the church we're praying for in our community is Northwest Community Church. You know, it's a privilege for us to pray for each of the Bella Vista churches on a regular basis here in the church, on a weekly basis. So we're excited today to pray for Northwest Community Church. Be faithful in your prayer for the pastor, for the church family, for the church's mission and ministry. And now I invite you to go with me before the Lord's throne of grace in prayer as together we offer to the Lord our prayer song.
Oh,
Faithful God, we come before you this morning. You are God of greatness. You are God of holiness. You are God who is constant in all that you are. We come before you, recognizing our dependence upon your grace. Coming before you with thankfulness in our heart, that you are the God who sustains us, provides for us, enables us, heals, transforms, and leads. Once again, we find ourselves nationally in a day of confusion. Threat of evil. And continually, Lord, we depend upon you to destroy the enemy of evil, to bring forth peace, to revive and to restore hearts and mindsets in unity. We pray for persons worldwide and nationally who are suffering because of the devastation of evil that is beyond our comprehension. And we ask you, Lord, in every way to destroy the demons, destroy the personification, destroy the influence of evil that seeks to destroy us. Father, before your throne of grace, we lift up Martha Grant and her family and her mother's death. We intercede on behalf of Wayne Calhoun and pray for him and for his family as they gather today to celebrate RMA's life. And we use the word celebrate because truly we do celebrate life, because life lasts beyond this life into eternity. But Father, we also sorrow, because death separates. So we ask you, through the power of your Holy Spirit, to bring help and hope and comfort to all those that are experiencing the emotions that death brings. Father, today we pray for Bud Hinkey as he prepares for his heart surgery today. And we pray for his wife, Dorothy, and for all those that will assist and provide. We pray for his full recovery and strength. Thank you, Father, for your faithfulness and for the healing that's taking place for Bobby Platt and for precious little Emery Antoine. We thank you, Father, that you are God who is faithful at all times. And we celebrate the birth of Tice for his parents, for his family, for his great-grandmother, for the lineage of love that surrounds him. We pray for those that will be traveling this week for celebrations, for family gatherings. And we pray, too, for those this week that sense a greater amount of loneliness because of changes in life. You just melt your love over each person, so that in no way do we feel a sense of loneliness, but we feel a sense of love. Father, you are our God who is faithful. And we thank you for the ministry of Oasis that you are using to help transform lives, and for the relationships we have with so many of the women. We thank you for all that's taking place through your provision, through your faithfulness, and through your love. Forgive us of our sin, Lord. Restore us in your righteousness. And create within us a heart that continually yearns to be more like you. It is our privilege to gather in prayer and to pray the prayer that you have taught us to pray. As together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
you pray with me this morning? Holy and gracious God, illuminate your word for us this morning, that we may be changed, that we may be transformed. Lord, I pray that you speak through me or in spite of me, but that each person here receive what it is that you know is needed. In Christ's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. I want you to think of something good that happened this week. I'm serious. Like, think of something good that happened to you this week. Maybe it was a phone call or an email. Perhaps it was a compliment that you received. Maybe it was an exceptional golf game. Maybe it was a day of good mobility and less pain where your spirits were high. Have you got it? Have you got the thing the good thing that happened this week? Do you have it in your mind? Because I want to ask you some questions about it. Was it something that you expected? Or was it a surprise? Would you have considered it an answer to prayer? Did you say thank you for it? Did you give God thanks for that good thing that happened in your life? Recently, I had the opportunity to serve on a retreat team. And there were months of preparation that went into this retreat. And we began praying months ago for the leadership and for the participants, for even the facility, that all would run smoothly and that everyone that was there would feel the presence of God in their lives. As we gathered for the closing prayer, the leadership team gathered and was holding hands. And a woman there reminded us of something that I had not heard before, and it caught me up short. She said, you know, for every prayer request that we make, for the time that we spend asking God to intervene in our lives, we should spend an equal amount of time thanking God for God's presence. I don't know about you, but I fall short on that. I may say a quick thank you or acknowledge God, but I don't know that I spend as much time thanking God as I do asking God and petitioning God for myself or for others. We are going to talk today about living in thanksgiving. Thanks living. And you know, it's a conscious choice to live in thanksgiving. Brother Jamie told us about that last week, that it's a choice that we make. But you know, living in thanksgiving also requires us to be cognizant and to remember the ways that God is acting in our lives. Our scripture passage this morning comes from 1 Chronicles 16. And I want to give you just a little bit of a setting and a history for this scripture passage. You see, David has just conquered Jerusalem, and he's going to make it the city of David. But the thing he wants to do is he wants to bring the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. So the Ark of the Covenant at that time represented the presence of God. Some believed that God was actually in the Ark of the Covenant, but it was the central part of the Israelite worship, wherever the Ark was. And you may remember what had happened. The Philistines had captured the Ark of the Covenant, and they'd taken it to their country. And a series of calamities happened to them, and they were a little bit suspicious that maybe they shouldn't hold on to the Ark of the Covenant. And so they returned it back to the Israelite people. It made it as far as Kiriath-Jearim. You see, the problem was that Saul was the king at that time, and he did not put as much importance in God and worship as perhaps he should have. He was more concerned about conquering other lands and defending his territory than he was about worshiping God. So the Ark of the Covenant remained in Kiriath-Jearim for over 20 years. It was kind of out of sight, out of mind. You see, King Saul did not lead his people to worship. He did not lead his people to remember the presence of God in their lives. You know, this time of year, it's easy for us to get in that same sort of spot. I mean, with the holidays, sometimes it can be a challenge to remember God. There seems to be a lot of extra stuff going on. There's extra shopping, extra traveling, extra cleaning, extra cooking, extra decorating. Things that distract us from God's presence in our lives. You might even say it's two or three times as much work during the holidays and half the time. The lists get longer and the days get shorter. We can lose our focus. Instead of giving thanks and celebrating, anticipating the arrival of Christ anew in our lives, we're thinking about stuff, sales, our accomplishments, what we have to get done. Others, perhaps, sit back and wait, waiting for that invitation, waiting for that event, reluctant to commit to any particular event because something better may come along. We focus outward and not upward. And like the Israelites, we can forget God. And we cannot be aware of God's presence in our lives. Our scripture this morning, though, reminds us of where our focus should be. You see, David's focus was on God. The number one thing he wanted to do was return the Ark of the Covenant to its rightful place in the tent of meetings, to put God front and center, not only in his life, but in the lives of the people. You may remember that David made a fool of himself bringing the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. He was dancing, half-naked, celebrating, leading the procession as they brought the presence of God back into their lives. Our scripture passage this morning comes from 1 Chronicles 16. It's verses 8 through 12. Give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make his deeds known to all people. Sing to God. Sing praises to him. Dwell on his wondrous works. Give praise to God's holy name. Let the hearts rejoice of all those seeking the Lord. Pursue the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wondrous works he has done, all his marvelous works, and the justice he declared. David is reminding the people, seek God in your lives. Thank God for what God is doing in your lives, the way that God is moving in your lives, and praise God. You see, that people had forgotten God's mighty acts. They'd forgotten that God had heard their cries in the wilderness and had led them out of captivity in Egypt. They'd forgotten that when they were in the desert, dying of thirst, that Moses, through the power of the Holy Spirit, struck the rock and water poured forth. They had forgotten that God had been present with them as they crossed the Jordan, holding back the water and making a way for them to walk into the promised land, the land that they were now inhabiting, flowing with milk and honey. They had forgotten that God was active in their lives, that God's mercy and grace sustained them, that when they turned away from God, that God always forgave them and took them back time and time and time again. You see, David's telling them, remember, think about where God is working in your life and give thanks. Think about where God is giving you love and nurturing through people, through family, through events, and sing praise to God. He's telling them, make his deeds known. Make God's wondrous deeds known to others. In other words, it's real simple. Those events in your life where you see the presence of God, you tell those to others. You share them with others. It's called that big E word, evangelism. It's really that simple. It's going and sharing with somebody else, this is what God's doing in my life, and giving thanks. David's telling them, seek the Lord. You see, if we're not mindful, if we're not intentional about it, if we're not looking for the ways that God is working in our lives, the ways that God is touching our lives, then we won't notice it. You know, seeking God, remembering the ways that God is working in our lives, can happen anytime, anywhere, with anyone. We can tell those stories of healing, of restoration. I absolutely love it, and you, many of you may too. I love it when somebody comes up to me and says, Judy, I have got to tell you about my God story this week. It tells me that they have been looking, they've been searching and seeking for the presence of God in their lives. And you know what? We're both blessed by the story. Seeking God, looking for God's presence in our lives, naturally draws us closer to our Creator. It reminds us that God loved us first. It reminds us that God's grace is always sufficient. And it reminds us that we need to be a people of thanksgiving and praise. Our first scripture passage that we read this morning from 1 Thessalonians tells us just this. It says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. You know, sometimes we walk around and we go, what is God's will for us? Well, it's right here. This is God's will, to give thanks, to pray continually, and to rejoice. Thanksgiving in thanksgiving is a choice we get to make. We get to make it every day, and sometimes, depending on the day, multiple times during the day. It's not easy. We must be intentional. We have to be dedicated. We must want to have God's presence in our life in new and vital ways. But we have to be cognizant of giving thanks to God as much as we make requests of God. How many here make a daily gratitude list? Uh-oh. A daily gratitude list is one of those things that you review your day and you look for the things that went well, the things that you're grateful for, the places that you can see the presence of God in your life, where God's touched your life. Does anybody keep a gratitude journal or a gratitude calendar? I think I hear a few people rumbling out there. You know, the thing about it is, we don't have to limit our thanksgiving to one day a year. We're called to live in thanksgiving. And in order to live in thanksgiving, we must seek the ways that God is present in our lives. There was an internet story that went around a number of years ago, and some of you may remember it. It was really a number of years ago. It was one of those really old computers. And you can tell it made an impact on me because I've remembered it all these years. And I've remembered it because I realized that this story reflects that how I live my life now, how we live our lives now, will determine our perspective and our outlook in years to come. In this story, a woman who had been living in her home for a long time was no longer able to live on her own. She had become blind and was unable to see. And so she was waiting in the waiting room her very first day at the assisted living facility, waiting to be shown to her room. And the nurse came along and took her to her room, and they paused in the doorway, and she began to describe the room for her. She said, across the room, you have a big picture window with a tree outside and a bird feeder hanging from it, and there's floral drapes along the window, and in front of the window is a bed with a handmade quilt on it. And she began to describe more of the room, and the woman stopped her and exclaimed, I love it! And the nurse looked at her perplexed, and she said, you've not heard me describe all of it, and you can't even see it. What do you mean you love it? And she said, you see, before I ever arrived, I made up my mind that I was going to love it. I made up my mind that I was going to be grateful that there was a place for me to go where people could care for me. I made up my mind to be in thanksgiving. We determine how we live our lives and how we look at the events of our lives. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This isn't easy. It takes a lot of work. It's simple. It's simple to practice looking at the ways that God is working in our lives, but it's not easy. I have to admit to you all, sometimes I get in a bad place. I get a little cranky. Some of the folks up here could probably tell you that they've seen that a time or two. I know Dixon definitely could. Sometimes, you know, it may be that I'm feeling sorry for myself. Maybe something has happened that didn't go my way, and I get aggravated. But there's a song that I sing. I've been singing it for years. I actually burst into it this morning as I was driving up to the church, and I saw the beauty of the frost on the golf courses. And in the distance, I saw the bare trees and the limbs intertwining, looking like lace. And I want to sing this song for you, and I want you to join me in it after I sing it one time. You see, when I sing this song, I have never, ever been able to stay the way I was after I sang it. It changed my heart, it changed my mind, and it changes my perspective. It's very simple and it's repetitive. You'll catch on. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, Lord. Holy and loving God, we do give you thanks. And Lord, we ask that you not let us stay where we are. Give us the courage, give us the strength, give us the wisdom to make time in our days that we may search for your presence, that we may look across our days and we may see events, we may see people that we encountered, and we can see your fingerprints, your touch, your presence, your love active in our lives. For you are a God of love. You're a God of infinite mercy and grace. And Lord, we do want to be a thankful people who live in thanksgiving. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. I would invite you at this time, if you are not a member of First United Methodist Church and you desire to be one, to come forward. We would love to have you become a member. You can either do it by transfer of membership or by profession of faith, that Christ is your Lord and is the Lord and Savior of your life. We are going to, you can also come forward for prayer at the altar rail. Our final hymn this morning is For the Beauty of the Earth, and it's found on page 92 in your hymnals. And as we sing this song, let us be mindful of God's presence and of God's great love for us.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here this morning. We pray for you that you'll have a wonderful week of Thanksgiving, whatever way that you will have opportunity to spend it, whether you're with a few people or a lot of people or simply by yourself. We pray that in your heart you will have gratitude for all that God's, all of his faithfulness. We hope that you'll join us today at 2 p.m. and go in the knowledge our God is a God who's faithful. Faithful in our past, our present, and he's faithful for our future. And remember, you and I, we don't simply come to church. Who are we called to be?
Be the church.
Hey, I want to thank you too. Last Friday, we were in a kind of a quandary around here about putting everything back together after having the carpets cleaned. Janet put an email out that said, after 8 o'clock, come and help us put everything together. She called me at almost 9 o'clock and said, it's all done. You don't have to worry about it. So thank you for coming. Have a great day.